You are 10 minutes away from learning about one of the most powerful strategy concepts used extensively by the consulting industry. Fortune 500 clients hire consultants and pay them millions of dollars for solutions based on this idea. Pronounced as MECE, it's a four-letter acronym that stands for mutually exclusive and collectively exhaustive. If you manage to get a consulting job at McKinsey, Bain, BCG, or any top consulting firm for that matter, you are likely to handle huge amounts of data. Chances are that your boss will ask you to ensure that you organize your data in a MECE manner. Be more MECE in your approach, she might say. In fact, even when you're being recruited by any top management consulting firm, during the case interview, you'd be expected to use the MECE principle. If you cannot use it well, you will not get the green signal to join. This video offers a beginner's guide to the MECE framework with examples. So stick with us till the end. What is MECE? MECE is a strategy framework made popular by McKinsey and adopted widely by the industry. It is a method of grouping information into elements that are mutually exclusive, or ME, and collectively exhaustive, or CE. In other words, it's a process by which information, ideas, topics, issues, solutions can be arranged or put in MECE buckets with no overlapping between the buckets, and with each item having a place in one bucket only. That's mutually exclusive. And with buckets including all possible items relevant to the context, making it collectively exhaustive. A simple example of the MECE principle would be the classification of the population into age groups. Here, dividing the population into two groups, one group of people above, say, 60, and another group below 60, would be based on the MECE principle. The entire population would either be above or below 60, with no overlapping between the two buckets, making it mutually exclusive, and with all people included in one or the other bucket, that's collectively exhaustive. In contrast, a categorization of the population into one group of people below 60 and another of people between 50 and 70 would not be based on MECE. Why? Because people between 50 and 60 would be in both buckets, so it's not mutually exclusive, and some people would not be in either bucket, so it's not collectively exhaustive either. Simple? Good. Now let's build on that idea and try to bring out its beauty and potency. How is the MECE framework used? The MECE framework includes the issue tree, the decision tree, and hypothesis tree. Strategy consultants use MECE to segregate a client's problems into logical data categories that can be analyzed systematically and minutely. The framework is notably used at McKinsey, where data from clients' businesses is organized on the basis of MECE. Well-known frameworks such as cost-benefit analysis, 4 C's, and Porter's 5 Forces have the MECE principle at their core. Let's discuss 3 popular MECE frameworks with examples and learn how each tool can be used to solve the client's complex business issues. One method consultants use is to create an issue tree to arrange all the information that they have and divide this information into all possible issues and sub-issues. An issue tree is particularly helpful for solving large and complex problems, as it facilitates splitting them up into smaller and solvable problems. Issue trees get their names from their structure, narrow at the top with the problem statement, and wider towards the bottom, even as each level accommodates more specific sub-issues or smaller problems. But some trees are also created left to right, but the principle remains the same. A common type of cases in which a MECE issue tree is used is profitability cases. Suppose the problem statement is, "My restaurant is not profitable." An issue tree is created, starting with the problem statement at the tree top. The various sub-levels of the tree would answer the question, "How to make the restaurant profitable?" in broad, intuitive ways. Our top 2 responses would be, "Increase revenue" and "Reduce costs." The lower levels would also answer the question, "How?" The second level, with sub-issues of the first level, would answer the questions, "How to increase revenue," on the one hand, and "How to reduce costs" on the other. The answers under increase revenue would be increase the number of orders and increase the prices of items. The answers under reduce costs would be reduce salary expenditure, reduce rental, and reduce raw material expenses. On the third level, the issue tree would tackle the question, how to increase the number of orders. One way to do that would be to shift the restaurant to a busier area, and another would be to launch a marketing campaign so that the restaurant becomes more widely known. On the other main branch, under reduce salary expenditure, options such as fire redundant workers could be mentioned, and also shift to a less expensive locality under reduce rentals, and change the vendors under reduce raw material expenses. How does an issue tree help? It enables consultants to consider all options separately and exclusively and suggest the best option to the client. It helps create a common understanding among team members about the problem-solving framework and helps to focus the team's efforts. It facilitates work distribution among team members. Often consultants who create an issue tree may need to trim the branches, which means doing away with options that are not worth pursuing after a detailed initial consideration. In our example of the issue tree, about how to increase the profitability of a restaurant, increasing prices may not be an option for various reasons, and that branch of the issue tree can be left out or trimmed. To explain the concept, we've used a very simple example. In the real-world context, the problems can be much more complex. The suggested solutions would have to be backed by hard data so that they are logical and can be proven to be credible. A decision tree is a tree-shaped graphical representation of decisions and potential outcomes of those decisions, and is used to determine a course of action. A decision tree helps users understand the comparative advantages and disadvantages of each decision and outcome. A decision tree is often drawn from left to right. It starts with a specific decision denoted by a small square. Branches or lines are drawn to the right from the square, representing each potential option. If the option is a new decision, a square is drawn, and from it, new branches are drawn, representing new options. At the end of each branch, a circle is drawn if the result of the option is unclear. If the option leads to a decision that helps bring about a solution, the branch is left blank. A triangle is also used to signify the end of a branch or a path to a potential solution. Like an issue tree, a decision tree is exhaustive in its inclusion of decisions, outcomes, options, and scenarios. A user of a decision tree looks at each of them and chooses the best option. Let's look at a decision tree example. Here, the specific decision is to invest $10,000. The first option is to buy 10 stocks. 5 of those may give a return of $13,000. And the remaining 5 may give us $9,000. So the average return would be $11,000 minus $100 for the costs. The second and simpler option is to invest the money in a bank at 3% interest for a return of $10,300. Now the decision becomes easier since your immediate branches tell you what you can expect from each choice. Another method to structure a problem is to develop a hypothesis tree, which is the graphical representation of all MECE hypotheses that explain the problem. Hypothesis sounds like a big word, but it essentially refers to a theory based on some assumptions. In a way, the hypothesis tree is similar to an issue tree, where a problem is broken down into its components, which make identifying and solving it easier. But there's one key difference. While an issue tree splits up each problem into issues and sub-issues, a hypothesis tree organizes a problem around hypotheses and often provides a more direct approach than an issue tree. For example, take this problem. Pioneer Bank wants to increase the productivity of its sales. The two main hypotheses would be: Hypothesis 1. Pioneer can increase selling time from the total available time. And Hypothesis 2. Pioneer can increase sales volume using the available selling time. The sub-hypotheses under the first one would be to reduce or outsource non-value-added tasks. And the sub-hypotheses under the second one would be to increase the number of sales leads and convert more sales leads to sales. Let's have a quick recap. There are 5 basic steps to keep in mind while developing MECE hypotheses. First, understand the problem thoroughly. What are you trying to solve? Second, write down the problem statement. Take care to ensure clarity in the statement so there's no ambiguity. Third, list the options to solve the problem using a MECE tree. See that the options do not overlap, that they are mutually exclusive, and that no option has been left out, meaning it's collectively exhaustive. Fourth, consider each option individually. Evaluate the pros and cons. Leave out those that are illogical or trivial. And as you understand the problem better, include any new insight as an option. Fifth, select the best option and present it to the client. Good management consultants use the MECE structure for problem solving. A piece of advice they like to give to aspiring consultants is to learn to use the MECE principle for not only structuring problems, but also communicating solutions. Whether they're attending a case interview at MBB or sitting across the desk from a client, creating a MECE hypothesis helps clarify a problem. It's like having a roadmap when you're lost in unknown territory. If your approach to structuring a problem is not MECE, it is probably messy. That was a quick introduction to what MECE means and how it works with some simple examples. Pick up a few new problems and see if you can use the MECE framework to build an issue tree, decision tree, and hypothesis tree. The problem does not have to be work or business related. The framework can be used to gain clarity on personal problems too. But if you're looking to get into a top consulting firm like McKinsey, Bain, or BCG, simply knowing what MECE means is not sufficient. You'll also need a good MBA degree to get called for an interview. That's the part where MBA Crystal Ball can help. Many of our clients have graduated from the best business schools around the world and now work for elite consulting companies including McKinsey, Bain, and BCG. In fact, we also have former MBB consultants on our admissions consulting team. Drop us an email if you need professional career counseling or admissions consulting help. Good luck.